Will, 1 John chapter 3 here, we're going to continue our Bible study here. And it's a wonderful book here because it really shows us here how to grow in the Christian life. It also warns us repeatedly about false teachers, so that we have to beware of. Not everybody that says, Lord, Lord, shall enter therein, but they that do the will of God. And the will of God, of course, we know first of all is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. So chapter 1, he covers our fellowship, how that the Christian, speaking to the Christian, can have fellowship. Chapter 2, he speaks also to the Christian and talks about the young men, the old men, and the children and so forth, their responsibilities, and how some of them are still children and how some of them have went on, and the young men have become quite mature in the faith as time goes on. And then he comes on down, warns the Christian about what's going to pull against him. And that is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Goes on down and talks to the Christian about the false doctrine. You have an unction of the Lord. And refutes a lot of this Pentecostalism and this razzle-dazzle stuff about anoint our preacher with a fresh anointing. He never gets a fresh anointing. He got anointed when he believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. He got baptized in the Spirit, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into Christ. And he got sealed with the Holy Spirit, showing ownership after we believe. We are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So we do not need a fresh anointing. You're never going to get a fresh anointing. And I'll tell you this, just study. Amen. Be prepared when you come behind the pulpit, and you don't need any fresh anointing. You have been anointed once, and therefore that is for service. And every Christian has a service to do for the Lord Jesus Christ, whether it's a pastor, whether it's a layman, whether it's a Sunday school teacher, or whether it is just a person to witness for the Lord Jesus and be a testimony in your Christian life. We can't all be teachers. We can't all be pastors. We can't all be Sunday school superintendents. We can't all be deacons. But we can all be witnesses for Christ, can't we? We most assuredly can. So he refutes that. We come on over here now, and we find out, he closes with here, that we're going to serve the Lord if we're not ashamed of him at his coming. We should not be ashamed of him. Notice in verse 28 of the second chapter, and now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, that we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. Every Christian should be in that kind of fellowship when you're looking for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You want him to come. You're looking in expectation when those clouds will break and the Lord shall descend from heaven with a shout. That's the hope that you have as a Christian. But I'll tell you what, that's going to become dimmer and dimmer and dimmer as you, as a Christian now, if you begin to fade away from the Lord. But when you're serving the Lord, doing the very best you can, doing what God wants you to do, your eyes will always be looking up, even so come Lord Jesus. Then he comes on down. In verse 29, we'll just hit that one more time. Then he says to the Christian, if ye know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. Well, we know that that's not speaking about just being kind to your neighbor, and everybody that's kind to your neighbor is born of him. What is that righteousness? Well, the righteousness he's speaking about, if you'll just go right back in your verses here, and notice here in verse 26, he said, these things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. The righteousness, go back up here now with me to verse 22. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. So, who is he, everyone that doeth righteousness? What is that righteousness? Confessing that Jesus Christ is God in human flesh. Not just being nice to your neighbor or helping elderly people across the street. Not talking about that righteousness. Is talking about the righteousness we have through Jesus Christ, which no one can have unless you are in Christ and you realize that Jesus Christ is God manifested in the flesh. That's the righteousness. Anybody that speaks about, oh, it's wonderful, just treat your neighbor right, but never talks about Christ as far as being the Savior of the world. You got to personally put your trust in him. Well, then you'll find out that's not righteousness. We got churches all over this place filled with so-called counterfeit righteousness that do not believe that Jesus Christ is God in human flesh. They do not believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior. If they did, they wouldn't substitute it and say you're not saved unless you water baptized. They do not believe in the righteousness of God because they say, if you don't have a baby baptized, you're not going to heaven. That's not the righteousness of God. That's making God a liar. That's not the God I know. The righteousness is when we confess that Jesus Christ is God in human flesh, and only through him do we have salvation, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now we come to chapter 3. Chapter 3 is sort of interesting. We come here to verse 1. It says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not." Now I want to back up and just say a word about this for the children and the sons of God here. Now in the Gospel of John, there are two words. You'll find out that the word here should be children, because it is the Greek word T-E-K-N-O-N, technon. And that's what it should be translated. Now, in the King James Bible, they did not make the distinction many times between sons and children. Here, the Greek word is tekron, T-E-K-N-O-N, technon. It is not hurios, H-U-I-O-S, hurios. That's the Greek word for sons. So you might want to put in your Bible here, "This is children, that we should be called the children of God." Now, I just want to say this also. You might make a note in your Bible in John chapter 1 in verse 12, because it says, "As many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God." That's the same word, technon. It should be children of God. You'll find nowhere in 1 John where the word therefore is translated here. The word hurios, or H-U-I-O-S, hurios, for sons, is reserved by God in reference only to the Son of God. That's what it's referred to. John reserves that right. You'll find it all through 1 John. It is always technon, which is for children, the same as it is in John chapter 1, verse 12. Now, we're going to give you two positions on this to explain why that the Holy Spirit used this and how important that it really is. First of all, it's reserved, as we said, exclusively in 1 John for the Lord's title as Son of God. And you'll find that there. Now, the Son of God is hurios, but it's not used for the believer here. It's technon. Now, the difference between believers as children of God and sons of God is revealed in Romans chapter 8. So I want you to hold your place right there if you want to go with me over here to Romans chapter 8. And you'll see this. First of all, in Romans chapter 8, when it gives us this, we're going to take it here, first of all, in a practical and spiritual sense, and then we're going to show you the difference as far as the positional sense is concerned. You are a child of God, speaking now. In Romans chapter 8, I'd like for you to notice here in verse 16 and 17. All right? In verse 16 and 17 of Romans chapter 8, notice what it said. "The Spirit itself," or himself, "bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then we're heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs." This is our spiritual birth. Children. This is our spiritual birth. But now we come on down and we find, go back up here to verse 14, and we find out in the practical and spiritual sense now, we should be sons. Notice in verse 14, "But as many as are led by the Spirit of God," that means leading the spiritual life, "they are the sons of God." You see, now this is the practical application. Now, did you ever hear anybody say, "I sure wish they'd grow up and quit acting like kids and act like adults"? Do you ever see that? Same thing applies here. When Romans chapter 8 refers to us here as joint heirs, that is our spiritual relationship. That's when we're born again. That's when we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Terms used synonymously. But as a Christian, now practically and spiritually, when we are led by the Spirit of God, means we're leading the spiritual life. Then we're considered a mature Christian, aren't we? Or an adult. All right? That's in a practical and spiritual sense. Now, what about a positional sense? What about a positional truth as far as children and sons are considered? Hold your place and go with me to Ephesians, if you will. Okay, Ephesians chapter 2. I'll show you this. Ephesians chapter 2. In Ephesians chapter 2 is a very interesting verse here, in verse 5 and 6, because God looks upon you as you are already in heaven. He looks upon you as though you're already there. It's already accomplished. It's there. Now, we know we're not there yet because we're here, right? But in God's eyes, you're already there. It's all over with. You're already in heaven. Notice the past tense. In verse 6, he says this. All right? Here we go. In verse 5 and 6. In verse 5, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace ye are saved. And he hath, past tense, raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We're not in heavenly places in Christ Jesus now, positionally. But God looks upon it as though we already are. God looks upon you as though you're already in heaven. It's already done, you see. So what are you saying positionally about children and sons? All right. Go with me now in your Bibles here over to Philippians. Let's go here to Philippians, all right. Since God looks at us as already being in heaven here, if we go to Philippians here, we find out over here in Philippians chapter 3 that in verse 20 and 21, a verse that you're very familiar with, but it tells us over here, it says, for our conversation, that is heavenly citizenship, our citizenship is in heaven, isn't it? From whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus, who shall change our vile bodies, that they may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, whereby he's able even to subdue all things to himself. So we find out our heavenly citizenship involves the changing of our body to get to heaven, right? Now, since God already looks at us as already in heaven, and we are sons of God down here positionally now, or we're children of God, then when in the world do we get our sonship? When do we get that? All right, go in your Bibles with me now, if you will, and let's go over here to Galatians chapter 4 and verse 5. In Galatians chapter 4, here in verse 5. Yes, we are sons of God. God looks upon us as though we're already in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven, but we're not in heaven yet, but God looks upon us as though we're already in heaven, and that's when we get our sonship. That's when we get what is called our sonship. Okay, Galatians chapter 4, notice here in verse 5, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. When we go to heaven, that is our adoption. We're born into the family of God, but our full mature adoption comes when we put on our glorified body and our full sonship materialized in heaven. Where do you get that? Go with me to Romans now in chapter 8, verse 23, all right? Here we go. Romans chapter 8 in verse 23. Romans chapter 8 in verse 23. The adoption has to do with the redemption of our body when we receive the adoption of sons. In chapter 8 in verse 23, notice this. Here we go. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves, groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption. What is the adoption? To wit, the redemption of our body. We're children down here positionally, but we are sons of God positionally in heaven. God looks upon you as though you're already there because he knows the end from the beginning. But we receive that adoption when? Because our citizenship is in heaven, from whence the Lord Jesus shall change our vile bodies, that they may be fashioned like unto his glorious body. All right. Now, let's go on down, all right? Let's go back here to 1 John, okay? We just want to bring out that little bit there. There are several Greek words for sons and children, but that just very briefly makes the distinction there. Another thing it says, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God. But we should be acting like adults, shouldn't we? Because if we're led by the Spirit of God, then we're going to be known as mature Christians or adults and so forth. When I was a child, I spake as a child. When I became a man, I put off childly things. Did I not? Surely. Well, we should have. Some do, some don't. Sometimes I don't. But I should, you know. But we're over here now, and notice what it says, a very interesting thing. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. I'm going to give you the case of Bill and Sam. Bill and Sam had been buddies for a long, long time. Bill and Sam had met three or four times down after work at the local tavern or the pub, as they call them, you know, the friendly pubs and so forth. And always had their beers together and always told their jokes together and talked about things and so forth as men talk about. Well, a couple of months passed and Sam didn't show up. Boys begin to talk. I said, well, Bill, why don't you give Sam a call and find out what the problem is? So Bill called Sam on the phone and said, Sam, we haven't seen you around. Said, you hadn't been around for beer and you hadn't been down with the boys down here, your friends, and they missed you and wondered what in the world happened to you. He said, I don't suppose you got religion now. Said, you didn't hook on any of that Jesus stuff or that religion, did you? Well, that, and just sort of laughed, you know, not really thinking that's what it was, you know. Sam said, Bill, he said, a couple of months ago, I met a man that changed my life. Bill said, oh, don't give me that religion now. Now, no, he said, I met Jesus Christ. I'd like to tell you about it. Oh, come on, Sam. I don't want to hear that old stuff. I knew it. You one of these Jesus freaks now? I suppose you've been going to church. He said, Bill, let me just relate something to you. He says, you know, I was about to get a divorce. My marriage was pretty much on the rocks. And I was introduced to a man by the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And I found out he loved me. He died for me. I don't want to hear it, Sam. You know, I didn't call you to have my ear beat with a bunch of religious junk. And I don't really appreciate that. I don't want a sermon over the telephone. He said, well, Bill, I'll just tell you this. I really don't have much. You're not going to see much of me anymore. Probably won't see any of me anymore. He said, I've been reading the Bible. We've been going to church. And now I've been spending my time with my family. And, Bill, I'm happier than I've ever been. Bill said, I'll tell you one thing. I knew it. I knew it. You freaked out. Yeah, you met Jesus. He said, I just want to tell you something, Sam. You need to remember. We were your buddies before you ever met this Jesus guy. We were your buddies. And now you met this Jesus guy, and now you're going to dump us. You're some friend you are, old pal. I mean, what are you, too good for us now? Is that what you are? You're too good for us. You won't come around us anymore. Holier than thou. We're one of them holy guys now. Is that right, Sam? Sam said, well, let me tell you some more. No, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it at all. He said, I just want to relate this to you, Sam. He said, we were your buddies before you ever met this Jesus, and we'll be there waiting for you when that fades out. When he gets tired of you, you get tired of him, and all this, it's going to pass, Sam. It's going to pass. He said, you know, it's just some kick you're on. I just want you to know the boys and I are, we'll be there for you. We're your real friends. And he said, I want to let you know this. He said, besides this, you're missing out on an awful lot of fun, Sam. Remember the fun we used to have? He says, I'll tell you what, I've never had so much fun since I've been divorced. One woman? Man, you got to be kidding. You got to be kidding. That's not the spice of life. Variety is the spice of life. He said, you're going to miss out on her, Bill. I'll tell you what. Or Sam, you're going to miss out on these things. I'll tell you this, on all the fun. But we'll be there for you, old buddy, because this isn't going to last in your life. You met Jesus, but we're your real friends. Sam started to say something else, and Bill said, well, you just remember who your friends really are and the fun you're going to miss out on. Click! Hung up on. It's characteristic of probably thousands and thousands of situations. A couple of months passed. A couple of months went by, and Sam went to the door in the morning, as he usually did, to pick up the morning paper and read the headlines before he went to work. So he goes in, sits in a chair, opens the paper up on the front page of the headlines. Three killed in car wreck. Hit a telephone pole head on. Alcohol was the cause. Driver tested 0.28, almost three times the legal limit. Other two were intoxicated. He said, honey, for heaven's sakes. Called his wife in. He said, look at this. I can't believe it. This is Bill. This was my old buddy. I can't believe this happened at all. And there was a picture of the car, telephone pole, front of the car, steering wheel pushed practically back through the front seat. Three dead. All three died instantly. His wife said, Bill, or Sam, we need to pray. We need to pray for the families of these three ex-buddies you used to have. And we need to thank God you got saved 2 months ago, or you could have been the fourth victim. She said, you know, honey, you missed out on a lot of things, didn't you? You missed out on leaving a wife a widow. You missed out on all of the fun of leaving your children fatherless. And you missed out on all of the fun of dying a premature death by your foolishness. Honey, you didn't miss out on anything at all whatsoever. You have more in Jesus Christ now, and your three buddies are dead. The world really doesn't understand, does it? And I want to tell you something. If you're a Christian, the world will pull on you like it has never been pulled, because Satan doesn't want you to serve the Lord. He doesn't want you in church. He doesn't want you listening to the Word of God. And he wants to convince you that you're missing out on all of the fun out there in life. You haven't missed out on anything. Because whatever the Lord, and you put him first, he'll supplement and give you much more than what you had, because he loves you that much. Satan will tell you that God's holding back on you and you're missing out. But Sam missed out on a lot of things, didn't he? He missed out on dying probably 40 years sooner than he would have. He missed out on leaving his wife a widow. He missed out on leaving his children fatherless. Who played the fool? You can almost see Satan laughing. Ha, 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 old boy. I got your three buddies, and I'd have got you if you'd been dumb enough to listen to them and missing out on all that fun. So when we come down, we sort of get an idea of the pull of the world upon us. And notice again what it says. Wherefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. The world is not your friend. Yes, we have friends in the world, but the things the friends do of the world to entice the Christian to put Christ second instead of first are the things that will destroy your life as a Christian. You've got to learn to say no to the wrong things and yes to the right things and the things that Christ wants you to do first. And if you put him first, he'll give you the desires of your heart. Lean not to your own understanding, Proverbs chapter 3 says, but in all thy ways let him direct thy ways. Let the Lord Jesus Christ direct your ways and things will work out. So many Christians have missed the blessings because humanistically, lean not to thine own understanding. They can figure it out humanistically. Church is just fine for some, but you know, we don't want to get too wrapped up now. Moreover, it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Now, as we go on, let's go on down here, if you will. And we'll not be able to get this all in today, but we're going to start on it because I want to give you an example of an Old Testament man who could have been one of the greatest kings there ever was. And everything he could have become, he never became, because he would not trust what God promised him to be. So we come on down and notice in verse 2, and we're going to apply this to here. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, or children of God, and it doeth not yet appear what we shall be. And as we've said many times, the reason for that is, depending if you're willing to yield and do what God wants you to do, he has the best for you in life, if you'll follow him and put him first. You haven't financial. I told the young couple we married. I said, you know, I said, start out and give to the Lord. That's one of the things. You give to the Lord. Now, you take a lost person and they'll prosper. I mean, you can take them. There are a lot of people that are atheists that have gobs of money. But see, they're trusting in themselves. God's not even a problem. God just lets them go ahead and do it. Go ahead. But if you're a child of God, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. You want to prosper? You want to prosper financially? Give honestly to the Lord. First out of the paycheck. Not if I have 50 cents left over. That's not by faith. That's just enough to ease your conscience. Faith is giving to the Lord what the Lord wants you to give so that he'll bless you financially, and he does promise to bless you financially. Back in Malachi, and he said, bring the offerings to the storehouse. They said, well, how have we robbed? Said, you've robbed God. Said, how have we robbed God? You have a curse upon you. They were so deceived in their own mind, they're going to work everything out humanistically. If I have a little bit left over, I may throw it in the offering plate. You have robbed yourself into poverty. God wants you to trust Him. He wants you to have faith in Him. Yes, you have faith in Him as a Christian, but do you have faith in Him to walk the Christian life and see God's blessings come if you're obedient to do what God wants you to do? You see, that's the whole point. But a man in the Old Testament, as we're told in the New Testament here, these things were written in the Old Testament for our learning and our admonition. There was a man by the name of Jeroboam. The kingdom had been divided under Solomon because of his sins. I'd like for you to go with me to 1 Kings here in chapter 11, all right? 1 Kings chapter 11 in the Old Testament. Back in 1 Kings, God had promised, and He had promised Jeroboam that you are going to be the king here of the nation of Israel. You're going to be the king. 1 Kings chapter 11. It's very interesting here because, oh, he could have been one of the greatest kings there ever was. He could have been equal to David. If he would have done and believed the promises that God had made to him, and he ended up a total disgrace because he would not do what God said to do, and yet God promised him that. Do you believe the promises of God? Do you believe that God, if you'll commit your way unto Him, He'll give you the desires of your heart? Do you really believe that? If you believe that, you will commit your way unto Him and trust Him that He will give you the desires of your heart. Trust also in Him and He shall bring it to pass. He'll bring to pass things that you can't. He will do that. He will do that for you. All He asks you is just commit your way unto Him. Trust also in Him and He'll bring it to pass. Do you have enough faith? Yes, you have enough faith that Christ died and you're saved, but you have enough faith to walk now and do what God wants you to do and put Him first, not last, not second, not the leftovers, but to put Him first in your life so that He can direct your paths. Lean not to your own understanding, because there are things that you're going to try to work out, they're going to flop. But they won't if you ask the Lord's guidance, and maybe He'll show you another direction that'll bring you success. Whereas your way that you think it'll work out all right is not the way the Lord wants you to go. Jeroboam is just such a man, and such a tragedy, because he could have been one of the greatest kings along with David. Chapter 11, we come over here to verse 28 to 31, all right? And we're going to get a little background here, and then we'll keep going on next week here. But in chapter 11 and verse 28, let's pick it up here. The man Jeroboam was a mighty man of valor, and Solomon, seeing the young man that he was industrious, he made him ruler over all of the house, over all of the charge of the house of Joseph. Let's read on down. And it came to pass at that time, when Jeroboam went out of Jerusalem, that the prophet Ahijah the Shilonite found him in the way, and he had clad himself with new garment, and they too were alone in the field. Now Ahijah was a prophet of God. He caught the new garment that was on him, rent it in 12 pieces. That's sort of a shock to Jeroboam. But evidently he didn't fight with that. He knew that this was some kind of an object lesson. And he said to Jeroboam, he said, take the 10 pieces, for thus saith the Lord God of Israel, behold, I will rent the kingdom out of the hand of Solomon, and I will give 10 tribes to thee. This is the promise that God said with no if, ands, or but. Jeroboam, these 10 northern tribes are yours. It's in the bag. No problem whatsoever. Now, in verse 32, it's very interesting because he said, but he shall have one tribe for my servant David's sake and for Jerusalem's sake. Mark this down, the city which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel. Now he just promised him in verse 31, the 10 northern tribes are yours, but Jerusalem, where he wanted the 10 northern tribes to come to worship, happened to be down in the southern kingdom, into the tribes of Judah and Benjamin. Jeroboam didn't know it, but that was the first testing that he's going to have, and we're going to see how he flunked the course. As we go on, he says in verse 33, because that they have forsaken me and have worshipped Ashtaroth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, and so on and so forth. Notice in verse 35, but I will take the kingdom out of his son's hand, and I will give it unto thee, even 10 tribes says it again. These are yours. It is yours. I'm going to give it to you. When God promised you something, going to give it to you, it's yours. Good as in the bag. We come on over here and look in verse 37. And I will take thee, and thou shalt reign according to all that thy soul desireth, and shall be king over Israel. Verse 38. And it shall be if, circle that little word if, because that is the key. God's promise that he loves you. He loves to see the Christian prosper. He delights in the prosperity of his saints. If you give. Woo! If. There's where faith comes in. I can't afford it! And quit getting yourself so far in debt when you have to rob God. Because when you rob God, I'm going to guarantee you, you are robbing yourself. You've shot yourself in the foot. You've shot yourself in the foot. You've robbed God. You have a curse upon you as far as giving and receiving. So he says, and it shall be if. Now this depends upon Jeroboam. If thou wilt hearken unto all that I command thee, and wilt walk in my ways, and do that which is right in my sight, and keep my statutes and my commandments, as David my servant did, then I will be with thee and build thee a sure house, for I built for David, and will give Israel unto you. God made that promise unto him. In verse 40, so Solomon sought therefore to kill Jeroboam because he was jealous. But God's going to do away with Solomon. Solomon's going to die. And sort of very interesting, let's go to chapter 12 in verse 1. Now, chapter 12 verse 1, we have man's choice, and his name is Rehoboam. Rehoboam happened to be the son of Solomon, but God didn't choose him. So, not for the 10 northern tribes. So let's notice here in verse 1, if you will. All right, man's choice. Rehoboam went to Shechem, for all Israel were come to Shechem to make him king. And it came to pass that when Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who was yet in Egypt, heard of it, for he had fled from the presence of King Solomon, and Jeroboam dwelt in Egypt. So, as we go on down, and you can read a lot of this here for yourself and so forth here, we find out that when Rehoboam took the tribes there, he was going to take all of the tribes, all of it, all of the 12 tribes. So anyway, how God worked that out, Rehoboam, he went to seek counsel. So he went to the old men that had grown up with their father, with his father Solomon, and he went to them and asked their advice. He went to the young men and asked their advice. The young men said, Rehoboam said, now what you need to do, your father Solomon put a lot of heavy tributes and taxes on these people. That's what he did. Now you need to increase that. The young men give him advice. You're the king now. I mean, they'll do whatever you say. You're the big boss now. They're the little peons down here. You go ahead and do anything since you are the king. So he goes and he asks the old men that were there. And they said, the old men said, you know what? You better lighten up a little bit. Love the people and they'll love you. But he didn't pay attention to that. He didn't take the wisdom of the elderly men who knew the people. But they took the wisdom of the young men. Notice in verse 13 of the 12th chapter. And the king answered the people roughly, and forsook the old men's counsel that they gave him. And he spake to them after the counsel of the young men, saying, my father made your yoke heavy, I will add to your yoke. My father also chastened you with whips, but I will chasten you with scorpions. Sort of interesting. We find out then that Jeroboam sent one of his men out. He sent one of his men out to, in verse 14, he sent one of his men out, and you begin to find out that they stoned him to death. They stoned him to death. Well, Rehoboam settled for the two southern kingdoms, and he was scared to death. Here comes Jeroboam back, who God had appointed king, and makes him king over the 10 northern tribes. Now, you would think Jeroboam, he had everything. He was a man of God. He had everything. God gave him the kingdom. But Jerusalem was down into the southern kingdom, to the tribes of Benjamin, Judah, and Benjamin. That's where Jerusalem was located. So what happened was, Jeroboam began to reason in his own mind. See, lean not to your own understanding, but in all thy ways let the Lord direct thy paths. Now the Lord had already, remember when we went back here to the 11th chapter here, he said, I'm going to give you with the 10 pieces there, when the Abijah therefore ripped his garment off of him and tore it into 12 pieces, and he gave 10 of them to Jeroboam. And then the very next verse he said, you know, I've chosen Jerusalem for my sake. That's the city which I've chosen, where I want my tribes to go. That's where I want to be worshipped, is in Jerusalem. So Jeroboam begins to think about this, and he said, oh man, I can't do that. If I allow the 10 northern tribes to go down and worship in Jerusalem, they're going to stay down there. And I'm going to lose my 10 kingdoms. I'm going to lose my tribes, my northern kingdom. It's an amazing thing how we begin to reason against the word of God and get ourselves in more messes. Do you ever reason, it's not really important, they won't miss me if I'm not in church? I'm just making a practical application. And after all, really, Sunday nights is a little bit too much to ask out of a person. An hour Sunday morning, an hour Sunday night is too much. I really don't get pushy, Lord. Don't really get pushy. You got it all reasoned out why you can't come Sunday night. You have too much to do in your life that God has blessed you with. You got too much to do. Well, I've got a lot to do too. But church Sunday night is very important. I'm only using this as an illustration. I'm not picking on anybody. But you're reasoning away what God wants you to do and wonder why sometimes things don't work out. God wants you to be faithful. He wants you to put Him first. And I'm just using this as a very simple illustration. If the church doors are open and we don't have a Wednesday night service, where most of your fundamental Bible-believing churches do, where you're expected to be there three times a week instead of two, and we can't even make it on a Sunday night, there's something wrong. There's definitely something wrong. Either you've incorporated in excuses, Christ is not first, and what's left over, you're going to give Him if it's convenient. You have robbed yourself of God's blessings. And you will continue to do so if you continue to live that kind of life. Jeroboam. God said, you have the kingdom, Jeroboam. It's all yours. I've given it to you. I sent my prophet. I said, here's the 10 pieces. It's an object lesson to you. It is yours. Just allow my people to go down for the burnt offering, for the meal offering, for the peace offering, for the sin offering, for the trespass offering. They're not going to forsake the kingdom. You're the king. They'll love you for letting you go down to Jerusalem and worship. Jeroboam says, oh Lord, now I know these people. There is no way I'm going to allow them to go down to Jerusalem. What I'm going to do is, I'll set up a place at Bethel. I'll set up another place in the north. And they can worship right up here, and I'm not taking a chance of them going down to Jerusalem. But in the 11th chapter, in verse 32, for David's sake and for Jerusalem's sake, the city which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, there's where God wants the people to go, to Jerusalem. That's where He chose, but Jeroboam reasons it away. Oh no, I can't take a chance. I can't take a chance. I'll tell you what, you'll take more chances with life and lose out more than everything when you reason away God's will for your life. You've lost. Unless you come back and redo your thinking and say, dear Lord, from now on, I'm not reasoning away with any excuses or anything. I want to be in your will. I want to have the peace of God that passeth all understanding. We're not talking salvation now. That's being justified by faith. We have peace with God. This is Philippians now. This is a peace of God after you're a Christian. We have the peace of knowing we're going to heaven. I want the peace of God of serving the Lord in my daily life. I don't want to walk around with a guilty conscience and hoping things are going to work out. They're not going to work out because you're unfaithful. So don't expect it to. Oh, there might be some things due there, but the things and the blessings God has for you depends upon your faithfulness to Him. Poor old Jeroboam. Isn't it amazing? He never even got started. And he began to reason away the Word of God. I know one thing. We are to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is only our reasonable service. Is it not? Be not conformed to this world, the wisdom of this world, or any other thing of this world, because this world is an enemy of God. You may have someone that may influence you. Well, you don't have to do this. You shouldn't do that. It's all right to go to church. That's good in one thing or another. Maybe the Lord has other plans for you. Maybe the Lord has some great plans for you. But you won't trust Him and yield to Him completely. Lord, Thy will be done. It's my will. If it fits my schedule, I'll do it, dear Lord. And I don't want crammed. Amen. And for things involved in your life that's sort of squeezing God out, you need to do some house cleaning. You need to change your life. You need to look at the Lord who loved you and died for you in a new perspective. And you need to incorporate, Lord, Thy will be done. Amen. And I'll guarantee you, there's nothing better than going to work, living the next day, getting up and saying, Lord, what do you got for me today? Oh, yes, I've got a job and I got to go to work. That's good, man or woman. Give me an opportunity, Lord, to witness. Have I got my tracts in my pocketbook or my purse or my jacket if I'm a man? Start the day out looking for an opportunity. And already on Monday, you know what you're going to do on Sunday. You're going to be in church on Sunday morning. And you're going to be in church Sunday night because that's where God wants you to be. Do not forsake the assembling yourselves together as some have in like manner, but exhorting one another. And I want to tell you this. When you're out in the world all week, you need Sunday morning. You need Sunday night. You need fellowship with Christians. You need to be around Christians. You've been around them all week where you hear the swearing and the cussing and the pulling and the this and will you do this and the drink and everything else that's coming there. And I guarantee you, a lot of fun in the world. Nothing wrong with that. But God wants His share. And I'll tell you one thing. He'll get it if He has to take it. I told you this, and I'm going to close this because we gave this illustration once before, but it's a true story. When Doc Cameron was over at Midwest Bible Institute, boy over there was, he was the only Southerner that went to Bible college up there, all Northern over there in Minneapolis. He gets up there. He was befriended by a fellow by the name over there, by a good friend of his from out west. He come to Bible college over there. And come time to graduate, he was graduating that year. Didn't finish his two outlines that he had to make on whatever subject it was on. The teacher was one of these strict teachers and wouldn't let him graduate. Come time, they got up and announced, this man will not graduate with the senior class. Oh, he's furious. He left, went back out west, married a girl there, went back out west. Short time, she called. She said, Jim's went back into the world, said he's one of the most miserable men. Pray God don't take his hand off of him. Pray God don't take his hand off of him. Went back in the world. Said, oh, he's miserable. School began to pray. Sometime later, he came back to Minneapolis there. Plenty of work there. He was out working and doing construction work. And anyway, he was up on three stories on a big ladder there and changing the storm windows. There in April there, taking the storm windows off, putting the screens on. Big gust of wind coming along, blew Jim off of the ladder there, fell on the cement below there. And he said, you know, he said, our school began to pray. And he said, you know what? We just knew that Jim wasn't going to make it. We just knew that. We just could not pray for him to make it. We just knew he was not going to make it. And he didn't. Several days later, his wife said, well, we bury him here. This is our home now. You know, since taking him back out. So they summons the father and the brother and the sister from out there. It was Wyoming or Colorado, somewhere out there. And they came. And at the funeral, Bob Cameron didn't have that. One of the professors over there had the funeral. Now at the graveside, he asked the old man, he said, you have hope of seeing Jim again, Jim Williams? He said, no, sir. He asked the sister, he said, you have hope of seeing Jim again? No, do not. The brother? No, I don't have hope. He said, I'm going to tell you how you can. Jim was a Christian, but he refused to do what God wanted him to do. He led all three of them to Jesus Christ at the graveside. God got more glory and more souls saved at the funeral of Jim than he did while he was living. I'll tell you something. God's going to get glory in your life if he has to take it. He's going to do it. I don't know about you, but life's so short. I don't want it shortened up. And I want to give him. I'm sure not perfect. I make a lot of mistakes. But I'm going to try to do my best. Because I think, I was just telling Marge yesterday, I said, you know, I think life would be so dull. I mean, if I couldn't have an effect on somebody else's life by either witnessing, helping them grow as a Christian, telling them that Jesus Christ and see them trust Christ as their Savior and see the thrill of Satan, you old sucker, I got two from you again. And I'm proud of that. I love that. And that makes my day. If I didn't have that, and I didn't have where I could teach the Bible and see people absorb it and to grow and get a thrill out of that, what a privilege to be able to teach. What a privilege. If all I had to do was get in a van and ride around this country and sightsee, I would be so bored. After about 2 months, I would be so empty. I thank God I have something that has substance, and his name is Jesus Christ. He loves me and I love him. And he really makes life worth living, doesn't he? If there's something in your life you're not trusting him with, I'll tell you what, sweep house a little bit and get perspectives, things back in perspective. And I'll tell you what, it'll revolutionize your life and your thinking. And it'll revolutionize your relationship with Jesus Christ when you say, Lord, thy will be done. And you put your things second and Christ first. And I'll tell you, you look full into the face of the Lord Jesus Christ, and things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace. Amen? Let's just bow in a word of prayer. All right? Father, we're grateful to you. We thank you so much. Thank you that we know why, that you put these incidences, their true life. These were real men. Rehoboam was a real man. Jeroboam was a real man. All right, Randy.